So for most of my life, I've been looking kind of funny. I've been wearing something from my eyeball, something in my hand, generally something in my body. I've been looking something like that. And that's not the hardware, all the hardware. Most of the hardware is hidden behind my back there. This is a display on my eyeball, a keyboard in my hand, and a big computer on my back. I looked something like that in 1993. So that was a display called the Private Eye. You can see one downstairs in the exhibit. And it's actually a 720 by 280 computer screen. It was just red and black, but for the time, it was really good. And people always wonder, how could I walk around when I was wearing that sort of thing? So I'm going to show you how that works, right? I have this big display right here. It's covering my left eye, but still I could walk around just fine and interact with people. Let's show you how that works. So what I want you to do is I want you to close your right eye like this and hold up your thumb, okay? And now I want you to bring your thumb back until it covers me up. You can't see me anymore. Everybody got that? So you're looking at me. You're moving your thumb so it covers me up. You can't see me anymore, okay? Okay, Glass, take a picture. I need to get my bosses so they see I could do good talks, right? But no, so that's what you're actually doing here is when you pull it up and you cover me up, now you open up your other eye, and suddenly you can see through your thumb. At least for most of you at work. For 15% of the population, it doesn't. So you had your thumb out, you pulled it up, you have your right eye closed, you covered me up, you opened up your right eye, and suddenly it's like you can see through your thumb. And all this display was doing was putting the optics, like a display, like a microscope or binoculars, the optics so the display was in focus. Now, over the years, these displays have gotten better. Downstairs, you'll see a display in the lens of my eyeglasses. So the actual display is over here in the earpiece, and it shines onto a mirror on the side of the lens, through the lens, to this little prism that's in front of your eye. It bounces around there a few times and goes back into your eyeball. And so this is really my prescription pair of glasses. The display was all in the eyeglasses. Now the computer was still down here, it was still huge. But for 1997, that wasn't bad. Later on, about 2000, I had a display that looked like this. It clipped on my glasses. Now, the keyboard I use was something called the Twiddler. And it's actually pretty easy to learn. I have it here in my hand right now. And basically, what you do to type is you just type A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, just as it's there. And then if you want to do I, J, you hold this down, it's the redshift, that I, J, K, L, M, N, O, P, Q, blue shift, R, S, T, et cetera. And this allowed me to type up to 130 words per minute. So I could walk around all day and have a computer on my eyeball, a keyboard in my hand, and have my full desktop with me everywhere I go. Now, why would anybody do something this silly? Well, when I was your age, I read a book called Machines Who Think by Pamela McCorduck. And in that book, it talked about this field of artificial intelligence, the idea that we can make computers that are smarter than we are. I thought that was really compelling. I thought it was a very exciting thing to do. So, but I was thinking about if the goal of these people who do artificial intelligence is to make computers that are smarter than we are, maybe in the meantime, I can make a computer that helps me be smarter. Something that helps live my life with me, see as I see, hear as I hear, hear what I'm doing, look to see what I'm doing, and help me in my tasks on a day-to-day basis. And that's why I made these devices. That's why I founded this group up at MIT, called the MIT Wearable Computing Group, and we made lots of different wearable computers. The guy on the left is wearing a jacket where the keyboard is actually sewn into it. It's actually thread, conductive thread. A few of us are wearing different displays. The guy down here in the bottom right, he's wearing a computer that helps him play pool better. So as the balls are laid up on the felt of the pool table, the system looks at the balls and tells him how to line up his pool cue to actually shoot better pool. Really unfortunate thing is it was actually good enough to help my game. I'm a horrible pool player, but with the system, I was actually much better. Now, over the years, when you look like this, and you go to a conference, something like this, and you walk around with these displays, people come up to you and ask you for demos. In 1998, I was at a conference near here at a place called IBM Almaden, and two Stanford graduate students walked up to me. I was a graduate student myself at the time. And they said, "That's cool. What are you wearing?" I said, "Well, this is my computer, this is my display, this is my keyboard. I'm connected to the internet right now. It allows me to do lots of interesting things. Why do you wear it?" "Well, I wear it because when I'm talking with somebody like with you, I really want to write down notes of what you're saying that's interesting, so I have it for later." He said, "Well, that's really cool. Can you give us a demo?" So I gave them a demo. They said, "Well, we're working on an interesting research project too. It's called Google." The people I was demoing to was Larry Page and Sergey Brin. And then about 10 years later, Google is making these things called smartphones, these Android smartphones, I sent Sergey an email saying, "Hey, now that you guys are doing smartphones, maybe interested in the wearable computers again. You guys haven't seen it for a while." And next thing I know, I was out here working on something called Glass. So let me show you a little bit about what Glass is about.
Okay, Glass, record a video.
This is it. We're on in 2 minutes.
Okay, Glass, hang out with the Flying Club.
Google photos of tiger heads.
You ready? You ready?
Right there. Okay, Glass, take a picture.
Now, what we've done with Glass is make something that allows people to communicate more quickly to each other. I can say, for example, "Okay, Glass, send a message to Taverner. Hi, how am I doing?" And that just sent a message to my wife that's sitting over there to her cell phone. Not to put her on the spot or anything. But I also get messages back from her. I can get emails. And what the system does is it doesn't interrupt me. It doesn't pull up the message immediately. What it does is it taps my head with this little thing here. This is something called a bone conducting transducer. And it's not a normal speaker. What it does is it actually vibrates my skull. So the vibrations go to my inner ear, to my cochlea. You might have studied that in health class. To my cochlea, where the actual nerves are. And I hear it that way. I don't hear it through my eardrum. And that way, the system doesn't block my ears. I have no earbuds. And so if my wife sent me a message right now, the system would go bing, I don't have to pay attention to it if I'm busy, like say I'm giving a talk like right now. But if I did want to see what it was, I can just raise my head and the display comes on and shows me the message. That's a very powerful thing. And I can reply to it with just something like, OK, Glass, reply. You know, that sounds like a good idea, or whatever. Right? So what we've done is made it so people communicate better. As you saw in the video, you could also say, look up jellyfish, or look up how to say something in a foreign language. Matter of fact, with Glass's camera, you can actually look at a sign in Spanish and see it translated into English. I was recently down in Mexico at a museum, and I was using that function a lot. So what we've actually been able to do is give people better ways to communicate and better ways to access information, and that was part of my goal. However, when you have something as powerful as this, where it has both a high-resolution screen, it's 648 by 360, high resolution to me. It has a lot of sensors in it, a camera, a touchpad, a power connector. It has a full computer in here that's actually more powerful than most machines you'll find in this building, because it's a computer history museum. And now I have my full PC up here. And what I've been surprised at is what people did with this. Let me give you another example.
This is firefighter Patrick Jackson, glassware developer.
Okay, Glass, show floor plan.
He wants to give firefighters hands-free access to the information they need, when they need it. So one day, firefighters everywhere can work faster, safer, smarter.
Okay, Glass, show extraction diagram. 2001 Ford Expedition. Cut right here.
Because every moment on the front lines is a chance to keep pushing what Glass can do. Patrick Jackson, firefighter, developer, and fearless explorer.
Thank you. So one of the other things we've been looking at is not only can it help people like firefighters, but how can it help people like your grandfather, somebody who's losing his hearing. So a lot of people I know who are older, who are losing their hearing, they haven't lost all the hearing. They still can see, they still get a lot of it. They can still see your lips move. And they oftentimes can guess what you're saying, but sometimes they need a little help. What we've done for them is make a version of Glass where it listens to what somebody's saying into a cell phone, transcribes it so they can see it on the display and glance up and see if they need it. Oops, we've lost our audio again.
Today.
Pretty good. I had a question about the classes you teach. I wanted to know if I could help you at all with the class.
Oh, what a great offer. In fact, I'd like to show off Google Glass and this application to class.
How long have you been teaching here at Tech?
Jay, I've been teaching here since 1991, about 22 years ago.
I gotta head out right now, but I'll see you in class.
All right, super duper, thanks. Bye-bye.
So what's nice here is that this is Jim Foley, who, if you've ever played a video game, you owe him thanks. This is the man who helped start the field of computer graphics. And as he's gotten older, he started losing his hearing. And one day he said, "Hey, Thad, why can't I just use glass to see what people are saying?" And I said, "Okay, let's try it out." And the next thing I know, we had this application. Now, anyone can download this application for free and use it on their cell phone and glass to try to communicate better. Now, I've talked a little bit about these different systems, but one of the coolest ones is this. It's called Fido. Wearable computers are not just for dogs anymore, or for humans anymore. We're also making it for dogs. So what we've been trying to do is help search and rescue dogs when they're out looking for people who are lost or looking for people who are in an accident. The dog, when they find somebody, can reach around and bite this thing on their dog vest, and then GPS tells their handler, who might be miles away, where the dog is, as well as what the dog found. Did the dog just find the crash, or did it find the person? Right? And the dog can actually indicate one or the other. So let me show you another video of that.
Every day is Bring Your Dog to Work Day for Melody Moore Jackson.
You ready to go to work? Let's go see what's going on today.
Here at Georgia Tech, she and her team are working on a new computer interface. Meet Fido. Nope, not the dog. His name is Sky. Fido is his vest. It's technology that lets this pup speak to its owner.
This project is significant because it's actually evolving thinking about what's possible for dogs to do to help humans.
That is the ball. Vest connected. Hearing demo.
All right, and then we can see.
I heard the doorbell. I heard the alarm.
Good job. We based all of our sensors on things that dogs do naturally. So a tiny little puppy will come up and tug on something. So that's something that dogs retain their whole lives. Certainly dogs can bite things. They can bite and hold things. They can touch things with their noses. So we've taken advantage of that in designing our sensors to make sure that these are very natural interactions for dogs.
The first Fido prototype established how the vest and its canine operator work together to deliver messages.
Once the dog bites on it, the force corresponding to that bite is communicated to the rest of this small microcontroller unit, and we know that the dog has bitten it. And we have a stretch resistor that is used for their tugging sensor. These wires communicate this information to what essentially is a small computer.
So the dog activates a sensor, it sends a message via Bluetooth to the Google Glass, or it could send it to a cell phone, or a laptop, or your big screen TV.
The latest version of Fido has a bite sensor and a nose motion sensor.
Okay, so it's paired. And then now I can hear and see whichever sensor's been activated.
One of the very real scenarios that we are working towards is a dog that might assist someone who is hearing impaired. Maybe a baby crying, the doorbell, or very importantly, an alarm that might sound. The way this works right now is dogs will alert by nudging their owner or with a paw, and then they'll take them to the source of the sound. But what if the sound is a tornado siren? How does the dog take you to the source of that sound?
Now, Sky puts the vest to the test.
I heard
yes,
the alarm.
Good boy. One more time.
I heard the alarm.
Excellent, good boy.
Sky has aced the hearing dog demo, so now it's time to bite down on a new challenge.
We have a little demonstration that we call the toy discrimination. Let's see. Ooh, look at that. This is a very important thing for a working dog to be able to do. For example, a guide dog stops when it comes to a set of stairs, but it can't tell its owner if the stairs are up or down. Or maybe even a bomb sniffing dog can tell you what explosive they've smelled. Is this something very, very dangerous you should stay away from? Or is it something that you can handle and dismantle that bomb? So I'm gonna just ask him to tell me what toy I'm holding. Ready? What's this?
That is the Frisbee.
Very good. Ready? What's this? What's this?
That is the ball.
Very good. Obviously, having two sensors is great, but that's limited.
What's this? That is the Frisbee.
Very good. One of the things we're working on right now is called a location study. So we're looking at different places on the body that dogs can reach.
Melody thinks they'll eventually have a dozen or more messages on each vest. But it all depends on whether a dog can learn to use the system in the real world.
We tested 8 dogs in a formal study of 5 different sensors. The longest it took any of the dogs to learn any of the sensors was less than half an hour. The fastest was 27 seconds.
So Sky has offered a challenge, something completely new to him.
This is a red recording disc. Sky has never seen this before, so I'm gonna show it to him, see if he does anything. Okay, so this proves he's not trained. When I show him this, he doesn't do anything because it's not on a cue at all. So let's use the one on the right, just arbitrarily. Sky, come here, Fleety. Good boy. So what I'm gonna do is I'm going to first show the disc, say prox, good boy. And I'm gonna reward that. I'm gonna take the disc away so that I'm presenting the stimulus, which is the disc, watch me. Good boy. He's already got it. One trial. This is a very smart dog. Watch me. Yes. Good boy. Okay, so now let's test and see if he really does know this. So I'm gonna have one of his familiar objects. This is his Frisbee that we tried before. And now I'm going to have this brand new object that he just learned a few seconds ago. Ready? Okay. Good boy. Very good. That's how smart he is. What's this? Yeah, so that's the familiar one that he already knew. Good boy, let's try that again. Ready? What's this? Yes, good boy. You notice I'm doing it all in the same hand, so he's not getting any other cue than the object. Ready? What's this? Yes, good boy. And you see he has learned it. What's this?
There are more trials ahead with different breeds of dogs, but it's clear this technology is already changing the way dogs help people.
We are actually giving the dogs more capability, which greatly helps their owners and possibly makes them more independent. So it's such a win-win.
Okay. One of the reasons I wanted to show you that system was the hardware that we're using there is basically the same thing that you all have been using from today for doing that sound project. So which team actually did the little Arduino Pi sound thing where you're making it play sounds, right? So that same board, that same chip and sound system is what we're using in that dog vest, right? And you guys can now take the same tools that I'm using in my lab and do stuff yourself. And all we're adding is a few sensors to it and then teaching the dog how to do these things. Okay, so hopefully I've given you some idea today of how we can make wearable computers that help make people smarter, make people more independent, help people communicate better. But hopefully I've also shown you an intriguing glance at how we might actually use these wearable computers to help communicate with animals better as well. Thank you very much, and I'll take any of your questions.
Great. Thank you so much, that was amazing. So what kind of questions do you guys have for Thad? He's been doing some really incredible work. So let's start over on that side.
Can you get the Google Glasses now or later? When?
Google Glass, this is the experimental version, and so it was quite expensive. And so it was available for about a year or two. And now they're working towards making a consumer product later on. So you can't get this right now unless you're a company. They're now giving it to companies to try out. They already gave it to individual people called explorers. So it's with companies right now, and then after that, there'll be some consumer stuff, some other wearable computers coming out.
Okay, I've got another question over here.
Where can you buy the Google Glass?
Well, when it was available, you can just go to google.com/glass, and that's where you could buy it, but that program is now over, I'm afraid. You'll have to wait for the next version. Keep watching the news.
Okay, right over here.
Was your speech on your glasses while you were saying it? Are you, like, able to do that?
Generally, I do. Generally, when I'm talking, I have notes about what I want to say, but you can tell when I'm doing it because it lights up. So if you look there, you can see it's on, right? And now it's off, right? But it turns out that I had to, because we're recording today, I had to change my talk at the last minute, so I don't have the notes I normally would up here. But yeah, when I'm teaching at Georgia Tech, yeah, I use it to cheat.
All right, we got another question over here.
How do you put it on, or does it hurt too? Like,
No, well, it's actually lighter than my old glasses. If you look to see, I'm not talking about my old computer glasses. I'm talking about my old regular glasses. This weighs 45 grams. It's very light. Here, you can feel that, right? Oops, I'm gonna get away from the speaker, right? So there's not much there. And what's nice is that you buy, when you buy these things, you buy them from Google, and it's just like a pair of frames you buy at the doctor's office, and then you grind the lenses for the frames for your prescription. You got a follow-up question?
Do you play video games on it? Can you play video games on
it? Yes, you can play video games on it.
Okay, we got one right here. Over here.
How do you actually, if this is a, wait, how do you actually play the video games?
How do you play different video games?
Yeah.
Well, one thing is with head motion, and one thing with a speech, and you can also do it with the trackpad on the side. So let me show you here. So that's what I see. That's the default screen. And now I can control it just by talking to it. Okay, Glass. Explore the stars. Okay, so now what it's doing is it's loading in a constellation map of the galaxy. And as I'm going to move my head around, you will see that it shows me where the stars would be if it wasn't daytime. So if I look over here, actually apparently the moon is over there right now. And it's now telling me in my earpiece, as I sit there and focus on it, it's actually telling me information about the moon. Let's look somewhere else. Gamma Chemi Berenices, whatever that is. It's an orange giant. I don't recognize the constellation. Let's try something else. Let's do Mercury. Right now, it's at the constellation of Gemini. So you can see, as I turn my head around, it re-renders the screen. I don't know how well it's doing it for you. It's looking very smooth here, but it takes some time to show it on the screen from my phone because it's a Bluetooth connection. So there's a couple games you can get. Some of them include doing gestures like this. So you've seen Fruit Ninja? Yeah? So there's a little camera here, and you can actually watch as you cut the fruit, right, as it pops up on the screen. There's another one called Geoboids, where aliens are invading the local area you are in, and you end up doing this to capture the invading robots. And you have to go from spot to spot to grab them. So who has a microphone next?
Thank you. We've got another question over here.
Okay.
Are there any flaws with the Google Glass?
Of course. There's lots of flaws with every computer you use. I think probably the biggest one with this, the most difficult thing to overcome is battery life. If you're going to play like a really intensive game, like one of those first-person shooters, or if you're going to play a simulation game over a long period of time, this is only going to last about 60 minutes. It's more designed for fast interactions like messages, like I do with my wife, or your calendar, or taking a picture or a 10-second video. So if you're trying to do, you know, one of those long games, it's not the best thing for it unless you plug it in. So battery is always the biggest problem, just like with cell phones. Okay, who has the microphone next?
Right over here.
Okay.
How long did it take to develop the Google Glass?
It took me 25 years. So I started making my first system. I got serious about it in 1990. I joined Google on October 4th, 2010. And so by December, we had our first system. But it looked horrible. It was this backpack system with even worse display than before, a big display. And I had a cell phone strapped to the side of my head for the touchpad. And I have video of one of the founders of Google, Sergey, walking around this thing and trying it out. So we got our first prototype done within a couple of months. But then it took about another 2 years before it started looking like this. And then about another year before we finally got to some place where we could hand out the experimental version to people. So it takes a while. Generally, it takes about 5 years before you can actually start a new product like this, really. Who's got the next
Great, we've got another question over here.
Okay.
How much would it cost if you the Google Glass if you could buy it right now?
Well, the experimental version was $1,500. But if you think about it, the first mobile phone back in 1982, the first cell phone cost $10,000. And it lasted, it had about 30 minutes of talk time. Right? So, you know, when you're making the first of something, it takes a while to get it cheaper and get it better.
Okay, right over here.
Where are we?
Here I am.
Ah, there you go.
Can I try it on?
Can you try it on? Unfortunately, it's my prescription. So if you look through it, it's like putting on somebody else's glasses. You can't really see very well.
All right, I've got another question over here.
Okay.
Can you watch YouTube on it?
Yes, you can watch YouTube on it. I wouldn't recommend it. I have been on my, I was fixing the roof of my house once. And I said, okay, Glass, Google, how do I fix a shingle? And I pulled up a little YouTube video and showed me how to replace the shingle. And so you can do it for things like that, but I wouldn't do it for anything, you know, more than 30 seconds or so. Okay,
right over here.
How long would the battery last if you use it for texting or talking?
For texting all day, I get about 15 hours of battery life.
Great.
Very good question, by the way. That's how you actually end up using this thing the most.
All right, we've got another question here for you.
First, I have a question. Will it, like, when you look at the glasses, will it affect your eyes like normal screens do?
I don't quite understand the question. Try it again.
Like, when you look at TV, say, your eyes get ruined, right?
Yeah, that's
good. Like, they get weaker. Does your glasses do that, too?
Well, the problem with the TV, it depends on how you watch TV. If you sit too close, your eyes tend to end up at the same focus. It's like people use laptops too much. Their eyes get strained because they're too close to it. This thing uses optics, so the focus is actually 2 meters out. So it's actually much easier on your eyes than most computer screens ever are.
Also, I have a question. Like, how did you design this thing?
A lot of iteration. So the only way to design this sort of stuff, especially when you're doing something new, is to do it again and again, try it again and again, and use it in your real life. So I've been wearing these sorts of things since 1993, and was continually improving it, continually testing out new things. I got lots of people to help me with it. Lots of other people were interested. And we figured out the only way to really understand this stuff is to use it in our daily life and to sort of live the future. And so if you ever are interested in this sort of stuff, you know, get yourself some hardware kits, work on this sort of stuff, make something any way you can, even if it's just a simple mock-up, and just try to use it in your daily life.
Okay, right over here in the front.
Got it.
Can you have native apps on the Google Glass?
Can you what?
Native apps.
Like, you're on native apps. Well, the thing is designed so that you can actually do anything you want with it. So there's a set of things you can do called glassware. You can download from the web and run on here. And there are a lot of cloud-based apps. If you want to, you can actually download Linux and run anything you want on it. Right? You can sideload Android apps too. And if you go out and look on the web, you'll find out how to do it.
Great, we've got another question here.
Can you use social media on there?
Yes, matter of fact. Do you mind if I take your picture? Can I take your picture? Yeah? Here, let's do this. I'll show you how I use this. So we'll actually share your picture with the Glass team right now. Ready? So, okay, Glass, take a picture. And if you look in there, you can kind of see yourself. See? Right? So now what I'm going to do is say, okay, Glass, share this with the Google Glass team. Right? And so now my friends next door, this is my little team working on glass. They just got your picture. They're probably being very confused.
Okay, right over here.
Can you get it without glass?
Sorry, try it again.
Can you get it without glass?
Can I do what without glass?
You get Google Glasses, but just without the glass.
Can I get Google Glass?
Yes.
Without glasses,
so if
yeah,
you don't
without
wear
eyeglasses.
Glasses.
Yeah. So the default one is actually, I can show you here actually. Let me show you. So that's how it normally looks. There are no eyeglasses here. It's just a band that goes across your head and some set of nose pads. So it's designed naturally for people without glasses. Matter of fact, I think, nope. Yeah, there Alex is actually using it. You can see that she's not wearing glasses. It's kind of an interesting thing here. So Alex actually has tetraplegia. All four limbs, she has difficulty with them. And she's been in a power chair after an automobile accident. And what she's now using glass for is to keep in touch with her friends. So her friends can SMS her. It goes bing. She looks up. She sees what they're saying. And then she can say, OK, glass, reply with her message. And so that's given her a lot of independence that she didn't have before. It's kind of a surprise, even though I do a lot of work with people with spinal cord injuries, I was really quite surprised at how well she was able to use glass.
Great. One question over here.
How long did it take to charge?
If you have it completely off, right, nothing running, it takes as little as 20 minutes. If you're doing stuff with it, when it's running, it'll take more like an hour and a half.
Okay, question here in the back. Very back.
There we go.
Yep.
Do you use it when you travel?
All the time. I use it 18 hours a day. These are my normal glasses. If I take these off, I can't see properly. I have been using this thing basically almost every waking minute for the past few years.
Great. We have another question kind of relating to that over here.
Yep.
Can you attach it to glasses?
No, what you do is you buy frames, and then you get your lenses ground for the frames. So it's like picking out a pair of frames at the doctor's office. And there's lots of different frames you can get. You can get, Diane von Furstenberg, DVF, has some frames. Maya and Ray-Ban has some frames for it. There's a lot of different people who have been making frames for that work with it.
Okay. Everybody's talking about. We have time for just one or two more questions.
Everybody's talking about glass, and nobody wants to talk about the dogs. Jeez.
I know. Okay, here we go.
Where are we? Okay.
Sorry. No, I do not. I have a question. It said in the video thing that each time the dog bites or presses the button thing, I heard there was a GPS, and each time the dog bites it or touches it, does the GPS find where he did that?
Precisely. That's exactly the idea.
Like,
so, go ahead.
No, nothing.
No.
I think that's it.
So when you send the dog out to find, you know, somebody who's lost in the woods, and the dog finds them, it bites that sensor or tugs that sensor and uses the GPS to locate where the dog is on a map, and it sends that information back to the handler, who then knows where to send the police to go find the person who's lost.
All right. Great. We got one more question over here, and I think one last one on the other side.
Does it come with Wi-Fi?
Yes, it's Wi-Fi and Bluetooth. Both of these.
Okay, we got our last question right in the very front.
Okay.
How do you charge it?
Right here, there is a micro USB just like your cell phone. So you just plug it in at night. Yeah.
Great. And I actually just have one more question myself.
Okay.
So it sounds like you've been doing some pretty incredible research for many years. Mm-hmm. And I think as the kids were asking, as students were asking, they've got lots of great questions about it. So if they were thinking that this was a really amazing career that they would like to explore, what advice would you give the students here today and other students if they're interested in this type of technology?
Well, right now is the time to get started. I got started when I was your age, and I started studying math. I got very excited by learning algebra. I did something called a camp similar to this, but it was longer. It was at Johns Hopkins, and I learned a lot of math. I got very excited, a lot of reading, and I did a lot of experiments. I got a computer, I started programming, teaching myself how to program, and I just made project after project, had a lot of fun doing it, and I kept on looking for mentors, looking for people who were experienced and could help me and would actually, you know, help push me forward. So now this is the perfect age to start doing things like you're doing now and really getting some experience.
Great. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Huge round of applause. Thank you so much. Wonderful rock star.